All helicopters are capable of landing in water. It's just that most can only do it once. That said, there are a few helicopters that can water land and take off again, with the help of yellow duct tape. Okay, it's not exactly duct tape, but a super sticky sealing tape that prevents the water from getting inside the helicopter and destroying the electronics. The CH-124 Sea King has a boat hull design, allowing it to float on water for a limited period of time, which not only is a useful capability during emergency landings, rescue missions, and special forces operations, but also to earn some cool points to be redeemed with this princess later. That's because the pilot was none other than Prince William, who performed a waterbird landing on a lake in Prince Edward Island, Canada, while simulating an engine failure on the CH-124 Sea King helicopter. Cool points. But why, prior to landing their helicopter on water, pilots had to check in with their maintenance department. How CH-47 Chinooks ended up losing their water landing capability. What amphibious ops have to do with ducks. And why this Chinook's cabin is getting flooded is not what you think. Since its inception, the CH-47 Chinook was meant to have water landing capability. This is why the designers added sealed-off compartments on both sides of the helicopter's sponsons. The hull itself was also made watertight, with critical components being sealed off. And most importantly, the underside of the helicopter was specifically designed to not house any electronics. These design choices resulted in an aircraft that was able to land on water with waves of up to 4 feet tall. That said, the Chinook could float on water only for about 30 minutes. That's because water would slowly start to leak into the hull. Although, by installing a bilge pump, Chinooks could float on water even with the engines off, as long as the APU kept the batteries charged. Just like with the Sea King, the vents on the Chinook needed to be sealed, and an additional 27 drain plugs had to be installed. The US Army used Chinook's amphibious capabilities on multiple occasions during the Vietnam War, but the most recent employer of this capability was the Army's Special Forces from the 160th Special Operations Aviation Regiment. The most unique feature of water landing is the Delta Queen maneuver, which means, I had that definition open somewhere here, I was just looking at it. Man, I can't see what's in these tabs when I have so many open at the same time. There must be a better way.
7 years I've lived here, browsing the web. I spend my days contemplating life's deepest questions. How do I keep track of so many tabs? So I help Opera make a browser that's as peaceful as a quiet Norwegian village. Now, managing those unruly tabs is only a click away. It is just so perfect.
Wait, I gotta try this. With Opera's Tab Islands, I can easily arrange tabs into separate groups or islands that can be collapsed or expanded. When I open a new tab at the top of my browser, it starts a new group. However, tabs opened within a group stay connected, so that related tabs can always be found easily. I can also drag and drop tabs between islands and manage entire groups at once. Tab Island is a simple and intuitive way to keep your browsing sessions separate without being overwhelmed by tabs. So check the link in the description to download Opera, who's sponsoring this video, and reach the state of tabfulness once and for all. When the Special Forces require extraction in a timely manner, either from a river, lake, or sea, Chinooks would fly to a pre-designated pickup point. Meanwhile, the Special Forces would get themselves to that location on a Zodiac boat, as the Spanish Army's special ops are doing in this case. The Chinook would then land on water while maintaining some of the lift at the front of the aircraft. This would push the rear cargo hold underwater. To prevent all of the cabin from flooding, a water dam is placed halfway through the cabin. When the cargo hold is fully submerged, the Zodiac boat would drive into the helicopter. But this is much easier said than done, since the cargo hold is incredibly tight. If the Zodiac is not properly aligned, it could end in disaster, both for those on the boat and on the helicopter. In this case, the Spanish Special Forces come in quite slow. However, during real combat, Since bullets are flying, the Zodiac would normally drive into the helicopter at high speeds, which makes it incredibly risky. Once the Zodiac is inside, the ramp is raised slightly while the pilot raises the helicopter to drain the cabin from water. The thing is, this cool capability comes with a hefty cost. After each water landing, the aircraft needs to be grounded until it's thoroughly cleaned. To do so, the floor of the Chinook needs to be taken out. A corrosion inspection would also be performed after each saltwater landing. What's even worse is that water landings are extremely damaging to the wheel bearings, which means they have to be replaced. Because of this extremely time-consuming and expensive maintenance, the pilots need to ask for permission from the maintenance department before conducting water landing drills. In many cases, the answer was a, you guessed it, flat-out no, unless the helicopter was already scheduled for substantial maintenance. Only then the pilots would get the go-ahead. Over the years, militaries around the world that operate Chinooks figured out that water landings were not really worth it for several reasons. The newest generation of Chinooks, the CH-47F, has digital flight controls, meaning that the helicopter is packed with electronics. While older analog Chinooks had no electronics in the underside, the newer versions do. This means increased risk of electronics malfunction during water landings. Combine this risk with high maintenance efforts, and water landings were simply not worth the cost, especially when you consider the alternative. When it comes to special forces insertions and extractions, thanks to Helo-casting, you don't even have to land in the water to achieve your objectives. Helo-casting is a technique extensively practiced by the US Army to insert infantry units into an area of operations. This involves using various helicopters, including the Chinook, which would fly 10 feet above the water surface while traveling at a speed of about 10 knots. The Special Forces team members would then exit the aircraft, usually in pairs, and then swim to shore. What's great about helicasting is that you can teach it to anyone, not just the Special Forces, and it only takes about 20 minutes to practice it on land. After that, you just get inside the Chinook and you're ready to jump. But just because you can teach it in 20 minutes, it doesn't mean people can perfectly learn it in 20 minutes. While exiting the helicopter is quite easy, the real problem is what comes next: swimming to shore. Even during simple training, without any gear, it can be physically quite exhausting. Now imagine performing helicasting with 50 pounds of gear and weapons. For this reason, instead of making soldiers swim to shore, you make them ride. This is why sometimes helicasting involves an inflatable boat, which will be deployed from the helicopter for over-the-horizon operations. And that's where the ducks come into the picture. There are three types of operations that involve helicasting and inflatable boats: hard duck, soft duck, and rolled duck. When a fully inflated boat is deployed from a helicopter, that's what you call a hard duck. When the helicopter's cargo hold is too small for a fully inflated boat, the boat is only partially inflated during transport and is fully inflated at the insertion point. This is called a soft duck. Finally, a rolled duck is when an uninflated boat is deployed from a helicopter. And that's all good for insertion, but how do you extract the team afterward without landing in water? When it's time for extraction, in most cases, it's possible to find a piece of land near the body of water from where a full extraction can be performed, and this eliminates the need to land the helicopter in water. That said, if no suitable landing location is nearby, you can still extract the team by hovering over the water and having the personnel climb up a rope ladder to get back inside the helicopter. Yes, it's very physically demanding, but you gotta do what you gotta do. Although, you don't have to climb the ladder, because alternatively, the helicopter can just lift you out of the water using a rope and a harness. And this is exactly what this special patrol insertion extraction system, also known as SPI, is used for. SPI was developed as a way to rapidly pick up or drop off personnel by a helicopter in places where landing is not possible due to water or rough terrain. All you have to do is just wear a harness and attach a carabiner to the SPI rope. But even with all these alternative developments, some within the US Army are advocating for the resumption of amphibious landings, suggesting they still have some advantages. Let's say an enemy missile sinks a US Navy ship. Helicopters that cannot land in water would have to use ladders and ropes to pick up the survivors. A Chinook, on the other hand, would be able to rescue them by landing on water, so they could swim into the helicopter. Now you might think the water landing would speed up the rescue operation, but there is a reason the US Coast Guard no longer water lands their HH-52 Sea Guards and the HH-3F Pelicans. The Sikorsky HH-52 Sea Guard is capable of landing and taxiing on water in order to rescue those in need. But this isn't a fast process per se. In reality, it would take a few tries to fish a person out of the water. See, while flying, the onboard computers make it easy for helicopters to hover in place. The pilot doesn't have to do everything manually. But it's much harder to control a helicopter that's sitting on water due to waves and currents. Plus, the Coast Guard now has rescue swimmers, who made it a much faster process to rescue a person and lift them out of the water when compared to a water landing rescue. And since amphibious operations already came with hefty maintenance costs, in the mid-1990s, the US Coast Guard retired their last helicopters capable of water landing, the HH-3F Pelicans. But there is still one more reason why water landings are not as popular as they used to be, and that has to do with the risks involved. The Soviet Mi-14 is a helicopter that is still in active service. An interesting feature of this helicopter is its two inflatable barrel-shaped floats that allow it to sit on water with ease. Multiple versions of the Mi-14 were built for various roles, which included a passenger ferry, a military variant that could carry either a single torpedo or 8 depth charges, and a search and rescue version. But as you can see, operating a helicopter with giant rotors in even slightly wavy conditions can be quite risky. Unfortunately, in this case, only 12 out of the 15 people on board made it out alive. Aside from the helicopters mentioned so far, Sikorsky CH-53 helicopters are also capable of water landing. In addition, the CH-46 Sea Knights that are still in service could also land on calm waters and float for up to 2 hours. But the risks associated with such maneuvers is yet another reason why, these days, helicopter water landings are rarely practiced.